South Carolina football fans coming off a butt kicking at Fayetteville. You can't run the ball. You can't defend the run. You got two key defensive starters out. Are we going to ask you to be hopeful about anything facing number one Georgia? You're at home. We'll throw that at you. We got Chris Phillips on the line, the Spurs Up Show and the Daily Crow. Catch him right there. Chris, how you doing today?
Mark, appreciate you having me on, man. Always a pleasure to chat with you. And yeah, it was a tough one in Fayetteville, and the SEC grind is here, man. You know, there's nowhere to hide when you got deficiencies and issues, and certainly the Gamecocks figured that out the hard way, right? We were worried about the line of scrimmage offensively and defensively, and for what it's worth, I thought the offensive line actually played better. But, you know, the defensive front, I thought, was the story of the game. And give Arkansas credit, big physical offensive line and defensive line. I think they're going to be a team in the SEC West that – who knows? Maybe could challenge Alabama. Obviously, I don't think we're looking at Texas A&M as that team anymore that could challenge the Crimson Tide. So, Arkansas, a really high-quality football team. But again, Mark, as you know, when you get into SEC play, your deficiencies, you can't run from them. You've got to face them head-on, and that's exactly what the Gamecocks are doing. And we knew this early slate, this early portion of the schedule with Georgia State, Arkansas, and Georgia, that it was going to be really tough because, again, for South Carolina, their biggest question mark, in my opinion, was the physicality up front. And the first three teams they play, that's what their focus is, and that's what they pride themselves on. So it'll be more the same this weekend against the Bulldogs. Again, like you mentioned, you got them at home. It's a noon start at Willie B. Huge recruiting weekend for South Carolina as well. But, yeah, tough task for sure upcoming this weekend.
No Jordan Strachan, not just for this game, but coming off the edge the entire season, Mo Kaba. Same deal with him out for the entire season. Two huge defensive losses right there.
Yeah, no, for sure. It hurts. It hurts. Strong's a guy that I actually picked to be your leading sack getter this season, the transfer from Georgia State. You know, obviously was on the roster last year. Big physical dude, though, really athletic off the edge. And, again, I thought he was prime for a really big year this year. Mo Kaba as well. Same thing at the linebacker position, a guy who'd been on campus a few years and you know, you felt like a highly regarded prospect. You felt like this was going to be, again, his breakout year as well. So it's a next man up mentality. But, I mean, certainly, man, it's a defense that was already struggling to stop the run, and you lose two key guys like that. And now at linebacker, you know, you might see a guy like a Stone Blanton, a freshman. Obviously, Sherrod Green's going to have to fill in and play a lot more. Debo Williams, Brad Johnson. But, I mean, outside of that, Mark, you know, we talked in the preseason, the linebacker position was already battling depth issues, and up front of the defensive line as well. You know, that was something they had struggled with. So, you know, again, it doesn't get any easier. You know, I think, thankfully, you know, after you play Georgia, the matchups might become a little bit more favorable in regards to just who you face and the offensive lines, you know, you're going up against not being as daunting. But, yeah, it's two huge losses, and it's just, you know, injuries. A lot of injuries are just bad luck, and those two guys, heck, I think it was on the same play. They got hurt, tore their ACLs, so – you just wish them a speedy recovery. You know, unfortunately for Strawn, I think it's actually the end of his college football career because I think this was like his sixth season. So you just hate to see it. I mean, you hate to see it no matter if a guy's got another year left or whatever. I think Cobble will bounce back, obviously, and come back. But you just hate to see it. I mean, it's tough, and this defense has got to find a way to next man up. Clayton White's got his hands full, and, again, certainly with the Georgia Bulldogs coming to town, which I just look at Georgia, you know, I thought Arkansas – was just a better version of what Georgia State was. And Georgia is a way better version than what those two teams are, right? So, again, it was already going to be a tough task. Now you're down those two guys. It's going to take a Herculean effort for sure.
Yeah, so can you take anything positive away from Arkansas? Because what I saw in that game was a team that got dominated on both sides of the line of scrimmage. You know, we outlined you can't run it, you can't defend the run, and bottom five in the nation in both categories, and that's with playing Georgia State. We talked to you last week about the concerns that you can't push around a group of five team, and then Arkansas, obviously, that, you know, there was a puncher's chance there in the fourth quarter with a big comeback and a couple Spencer Rattler touchdowns and you know, but it was really never a competitive game after it got past 21-16. But that's the big concern.
Yeah, you know, line of scrimmage play is it's, you know, Mark, I look at this football team, and I don't think this is a harsh way of putting this, and it's not even really meant as an insult. I guess it's something that we should have known, like, no duh, this was going to be the case. This feels like the same exact football team as last year, just with a better quarterback. You know, in the sense of that a lot of your same issues you were facing last year, again, you're facing this year. And so why, you know, and I don't know why we didn't see that coming more so, I guess, or why Gamecock Nation as a whole, I guess a lot of folks, you know, blinded by their garnet and black glasses, if you will. But same five offensive linemen, a lot of the same guys up front defensively. Line of scrimmage struggled last year, right? This isn't rocket science. I mean, it's just the transitive property and carrying over. But positives from Arkansas, I think certainly there were positives. Having some offensive success, seeing a guy like Antoine Wells break through, I think it was 8 catches for 189 yards. He looks to be the part, looks as good as advertised, the transfer from James Madison, and certainly a guy, you know, that you hope is going to be a go-to dude week in, week out. So just seeing this football team have offensive success in the passing game, you know, Spencer Rattler, while he did not play perfect, if there's anybody out there who thinks he's not the best option for this football team under center, just throw you in the loony bin and get rid of the key. I mean, that's kind of the way I look at it. So, you know, I think positives on the offensive side, having some offensive success defensively, you know, I guess your secondary continues to be a positive. Nicky Manwari in the back end is a really bright, shining, true freshman. But, you know, Mark, again, it's like you mentioned, you bring up the statistics, and I know it's just 2 weeks, but you've surrendered 200 yards rushing week one, 295 in week two, right? Your pass defense ranks 15th in the country. Well, it's just like last year, right? Which is the reason it ranks so high is because nobody has to throw the ball, right? Because you just cannot – I mean, look at Arkansas Saturday. KJ Jefferson only threw for 162 yards. Mark, he went 18 of 21. I mean, they ran for 295. Why would you put it in harm's way? So you look at this game this weekend against Georgia, and I mean, if Stetson Bennett throws more than 15 passes, Georgia's OC should be fired. You know what I mean? Like, what's the point? Why would you put the ball in harm's way? At least going off of what we know. So it's a lot of the same deficiencies, a lot of the same issues. And here's the thing. They won 7 games with a bowl game with those problems last year. We'll see if they can do it again. But for me, the reason I left Saturday feeling no more victories, but somewhat positive, I think just seeing this football team have some offensive success, it at least gives you encouraging signs that, you know, there's life in the offense. I think we feel like once the matchups get better, Arkansas was a horrid matchup. Once the matchups get better, this defense will do enough to keep us in ball games and give us a chance to win. But it all comes down to the offense. So to see them have success, that was the big question mark coming in. I think did please a lot of Gamecock fans for sure.
Talking up South Carolina football, Chris Phillips, join him right there on Twitter. You see his handle right there, the Spurs Up Show and the Daily Crow. That's the lineup, right, Chris? Did yes. I miss anything?
Yeah, no. So the podcast drops 3 times a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Podcasts. That's under the name The Spurs Up Show. The Daily Crow is our daily live show, like you mentioned, that airs noon to 2 Eastern time, Monday through Friday, and that airs on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch. You can call a number. We have a call-in number that's 843-790-3377. Call the beauties and the banters, we always say. So we discuss, debate, what have you, have great conversation. We have daily guests on all throughout the week as well. You know, ranging from folks like Stephen Garcia, folks within the 24/7 sports network with South Carolina, JC Sherbert. We have guys like, you know, Pro Football Focus guys, Jake Crane of Crane and Company, and also my good friend Alex McGrath, who we'll have on today. So a lot of fun, really, really good stuff. And you can also check that out. The Daily Crow does drop in podcast form every day around 3 o'clock or so on iTunes, Spotify, wherever you get your podcasts. And of course, all over social media, just at the Spurs Up Shows where you can find us.
Chris, considering what we saw Georgia do to Oregon, considering what we saw in Fayetteville, isn't this season teetering on what you set us up for the entire offseason? You set us up for the positive side, then you said the negative. Look at this early season schedule, and if this roster and this team gets beat up physically and also gets beat up emotionally, then it could go south.
Well, and here's the thing, though, Mark, too. Through 2 weeks, this season, I mean, outside of Georgia State being a much tougher 21-point victory than I expected. Like, Arkansas went exactly as I thought it would. Outside of it being as high-scoring as it was, I did not expect it to be so high-scoring. But we talked about for months that it was a bad matchup in the trenches, right? The physicality of Arkansas, and you knew what your deficiencies were, and it was a game, a matchup of their strength against your weakness, and you were going to get exposed. Georgia's the same way. And here's the thing. Georgia is going to beat up on a lot of people. I mean, they're really good. We're talking about a Bulldogs team. They ain't surrendered a touchdown yet, right? Stetson Bennett's thrown for 300-plus in the first 2 games. I mean, I picked them to go undefeated, really, really good football team. But, yeah, I mean, Mark, like you mentioned, you know, if you do start this season 1-2, it's exactly where I picked you. You're going to have the two games against Charlotte and SC State, I think, to lick your wounds and to battle back and to sort of figure some things out. Then it kind of – the season, I think, Mark, will come to a head in Lexington against Kentucky. You know, I listed the Missouri game in the preseason as the most important game, and I stand by that because here's the thing. Folks think 6-6 is the worst-case scenario, disaster, failure. No, no, no. Lose to Mizzou. Going 5-7, that will be utter disaster, right? That's why I picked it as the game you have to win to have a good year. But I did mention in the preseason, I stand by it, that game in Lexington against Kentucky, that's the inflection point game. And I understand everybody's riding high on Kentucky right now. They just beat Florida. But if this South Carolina football team is going to overachieve and they're going to hit 7 or more wins, I think that's the game you have to have. Bottom line, it's just the game you have to have. So they've got to figure some things out over the next couple of weeks. You know, the schedule will soften up. The matchups will get better. But, yeah, Mark, I mean, like you said, I mean, we talked about it all preseason. I know the hype and energy and excitement from yours truly was felt. And, of course, Gamecock Nation. But I think Gamecock Nation's getting a heavy dose of reality right now. That, you know what, all that hype and excitement and all that hoopla is great. But when you get into SEC play, you get punched in the face. And now what are you going to do about it? You know what I mean? So what happened in Fayetteville, to me at least, and I kept realistic expectations all throughout the preseason, and I most certainly will not apologize for it. It was expected. It was expected. And there's a reason they are recruiting the line of scrimmage so heavily. There's a reason they are. They need the reinforcements. And reinforcements are on the way, but they've got to try to find a way to make it work with the guys they have right now. They simply don't have the talent up front to win and beat a team like an Arkansas or a Georgia. That's the harsh reality. So that doesn't mean they can't still have a great season, but that is the truth. And watching them play, who would deny that? So, again, positives to be pulled from Arkansas. But, Mark, to your point, outside of Georgia State being a little bit, you know, a little bit tougher, a little bit crazier than maybe I expected – this team's strengths and weaknesses and the start of the year, it's been exactly what I expected.